creating the device based on an entry in the device page. At the end of the day, what needs to happen is a bus is a device is created on the virtio bus, and then once that is done, the data path actually works directly between the device emulation code and the virtio device. So the host driver here supports a device create ioctl that allows you to create a device which has information on the location of the V-rings and interrupt information and status. It has a field for status. This is as per the virtio spec. And then once the device entry is created, the virtio mic module on the card side is able to then create a virtio device, and then you're in business. In the the rings are functioning and network packets can flow and so on. So if you're familiar with how virtio works in the case of KEMU and KVM, what happens is the virtio device is a PCI device that gets discovered using the normal PCI discovery mechanisms, and the PCI, there's some code here that allows you to set up rings, and then the data transfer is set up between the virtio net driver and the network backend. So in the case of the coprocessor OS and the coprocessor driver, this virtio mic block here is playing the same role as the virtio PCI. So it's in the business of creating the device and so on, and setting up the rings while working with the host side. Once the rings are set up, the data path actually flows between the backend and the driver. So the next part of the driver is high performance data transfer or PCIe. So for that we invented an API called Symmetric Communications Interface. And this API, the symmetric stands for the fact that this API is symmetric between the coprocessor and the host. So they are sort of peers now and sort of nodes over the PCIe network, on the PCIe network. The primary goal of this API was to provide PCIe transfer bandwidth as close as possible to what was available through the hardware. So that's about 7 gigabytes per second. Just as a data point, the TCP/IP implementation provided us a data bandwidth of 400 megabytes per second. And then the next goal was, we had this, we had multiple programming models, at least two, and we wanted to create some common infrastructure and code that would support these programming models. And so in terms of data paths, the data paths that SCIF supports is between the host and the coprocessor and between the coprocessor. So that basically allows for the offload model as well as the native model and symmetric models of computation. Now, in the native model, I also said that the communication between coprocessors that are on different platforms is through some sort of InfiniBand adapter. So the SCIF by itself is not involved in the communication, but that data movement happens because of the through the InfiniBand adapter. But SCIF is involved in setting up that communication. So that's the third data path that is supported by SCIF. Sure. Yeah. Well, because it's PCIe, you'll effectively get the same bandwidth between the host and the multiple mic cards. There is a factor here, and one of them is that the network stack operation itself on the mic is these are simpler x86 cores that have been augmented with x86. That may be, I'm not sure, because there is some serialization in the TCP/IP stack and so on. So, yeah, I mean, if you implement a lot, I mean, if you implemented a sophisticated network driver, you could probably get some parallelization there. You're right. Yeah. So, I mean, to achieve that performance, the PCIe bandwidth performance, we have the concept of RDMA or PCIe, essentially. And then additionally, we also support just send-receive for just two-sided communication. That's very similar to sockets. And then for the lowest latency message transfer between the coprocessors or between the host and coprocessors, it is actually possible to just mmap memory on a different process. On a remote process, and then that gives you, less than microsecond latency, message latency. Before I continue with description of SCIF, there are a couple of concepts here. So one is the concept of a SCIF endpoint, and it's very similar to a socket, and it's essentially a pipe to a PCIe node. It does operate in a loopback fashion. And it is actually ends up being bound to a port ID. So you have, just messages traveling between these endpoints. And then two endpoints, they form a connection. So once you have a connection formed, you can do RDMA over that connection. You can mmap memory over the connection and so on. So with respect to the API, the functional grouping is as shown here. You have connection setup APIs, those are almost equivalent sockets. Once you have the connection setup, there is send-receive or messaging on those endpoints. Then you have the RMA APIs, but before you this RMA, or folks know popularly known as RDMA. But before you can go to RMA, you need some mechanism to register memory, that is, pin down memory and expose it to the remote side. These RMA operations are asynchronous, so we don't have they can proceed in parallel with computation. So there is a need to know when the RMA operation has completed for sure. So that's the RMA fencing API, and then. Lastly, we have the remote memory mapping API, which is just actually mmap.
So, you said you were doing DMA off this, so is TCP just your control plane?
Well, yeah. So, the API provides its own control plane through the send-receive messages. So, you can send small data at hopefully a lower latency than TCP/IP. So that's used in the messaging layer here, and then but the RDMA itself is just DMA between process address spaces. Yeah.
Is it plugging into the standard RDMA verbs of open standards?
Yeah, it does. So basically, the SCIF API has two versions. It's the same code, but it exposes at two levels. One is a user space and kernel space. And in the kernel space implementation, the RDMA stack, the OFET stack, is layered on top of the SCIF API so that you can have RDMA or PCIe. But you could also just, if you wanted, so for example, in the offload case, we have a library that does RDMA from user space. So that makes use of the user space interface. So with respect to the connection and send and receive, it's very similar to sockets. The implementation at this point is just a character driver. So all this happens through ioctls into the character driver, and then there is also a kernel mode. These interfaces are both available in kernel mode and user mode. So essentially, In this case, these endpoints are these nodes are opening up endpoints. One of the nodes puts its endpoint into the listen state. Then the other guy, you know, sends a connect message. As soon as a connection is accepted, there's a new endpoint created here. Then once you have the new endpoint created, you can do send receive and RDMA and mmap and so on. So that's the connection API. The next slide, just a brief description about how it actually works. So at the point of creating a connection, we sort of create a receive queue on both sides of the connection. In this case, we have this particular process, P0, that wants to send a message. P1 here is on a different PCIe node, so it's blocked, waiting for the message, and this is the, it specifies message 1 as the destination of the message. And simply, there are drivers on both sides, so this is the kernel implementation of SCIF, and they are talking to each other through some sort of ring buffer implementation. The message SCIF send implementation itself is through some is through an ioctl interface. The message gets transferred to the remote endpoints receive queue, an interrupt gets sent, and then the message is copied over. So these messages are relatively low latency for less than about 1K in size. The PCIe network itself is assumed to be reliable, so there is no sort of checksumming or retransmissions and things like that. It's just a message sent over a ring buffer, essentially. You have two sides that connect up, and then they can exchange these messages. So, for example, these messages could be just some, in the RDMA case, for example, it could be just some RDMA control information. So it's a very similar to how RDMA is done on the OFET stack or InfiniBand and so on. So next I move on to memory registration. As I said earlier, we want to do RDMA, RMA, or PCIe. And so in that case, the goal is to be able to transfer data from a buffer in this particular process to a remote process. So for that to happen, the buffer has to be exposed to the remote site. So its pages have to be, the physical page location has to be sent over to the remote node so that the remote node can then do DMA to buff zero. So the memory registration is the process that enables that. And the pages are pinned because you want to access it from the local DMA engine. And also, the remote side is going to be accessing these pages. So these are the two reasons, obviously, that you would need to pin the pages. At a high level, this is RDMA using a local DMA controller. So what we need is the physical addresses for the local side and the remote side. The next slide actually explains some of the steps in the memory registration. So, at a high level, we need some identifier for the buffer once it's registered. So, these buffers are identified using something called register address space. So, in the previous example, buffer 0 was registered with the SCIF driver, and what is returned is an offset. These offsets are per connection. So every connection has two address spaces, a local registered address space and a remote registered address space. So when this registration happens, the physical page locations are sent over to the remote node, and so they appear at offset 0 in the remote registered address space of process P1, of the peer process. And similarly, process P1 wants to register its buffer, so that happens, and offset is returned. And similarly, this particular offset 1 is reflected into the remote register address space. And so once you have this particular this identifier, essentially this offset is nothing but an identifier for the pinned buffer, you're then able to do RMA operations between these buffers. So this is the prototype for the SCIF register. Essentially, you can register a virtual address, and then you can also specify the protections, whether you're allowing the remote process to write to that virtual address and so on. So this is the so once the registration registration has happened, so in this case, buffer 0 is registered locally. The remote end registered buffer 1 and sent over that particular offset over the send-receive API. And now you can use this, the RMA API essentially to do a transfer from offset 0 to offset 1. So the local offset to the remote offset. And so the flags allow specification of whether the transfer is synchronous, or there are some other things that we had to do for OFED. For example, if the last cache line arrives, essentially something to do with the ordering of the transfer and so on. So that is the API that's completely based on offsets. And then since the local, on the local side, we can actually use the virtual address also. So basically, we just added a V prefix to the write to API, and then you can pass in buffer 0. So, I mean, this has the overhead of pinning the pages at runtime and then unpinning once the DMA transfer has completed. So for buffers that are registered over a longer period of time, it's actually preferable to register it a priori and then keep using the setup buffers in the RMA API. So since the RMA APIs are asynchronous, so we need some mechanism to synchronize with the completion. So we have two mechanisms. One is the blocking mode for synchronization, and then the other is non-blocking. Here, the non-blocking mode essentially involves writing a value to a memory location. So for example, what happened in this particular picture, we have issued RMA 1, RMA 2, and at this point we issued a SCIF fence signal, which is actually going to write a value to an offset in a registered address space. That registered address space could be local or remote, so it could be, most probably it's going to be on the remote address, it's going to be remote address, so that the local end has issued DMAs, the remote side is waiting for the DMAs to complete, and so the SCIF fence signal is essentially guarantees that this value appears on the remote side only after the RMA transfers that were issued prior to the fence signal have completed. So this RMA 3 has no relation to this particular fence. So it can complete later on, but the SCIF fence signal essentially guarantees ordering. So this way, it's sort of equivalent to the fence instructions that are found on the CPUs. So that was non-blocking or polling synchronization. Now with blocking synchronization, it's very similar. The APIs are a bit different, where you mark a particular fence, and then you can issue your RMAs and then continue computation or issuing further RMAs, and then you go on to wait for the particular, at this point, if the RMA hasn't completed, this particular thread would be blocked waiting for the RMA. So that actually brings us to the last API here, and that has to do with just mmap. And going back a couple of slides, so we have the local buffer registered here, and it appears in the process virtual address space as well. The remote side has registered a buffer, and so it appears in the remote registered address space for this particular connection. Now, we want to be able to mmap that buffer so that we can, you know, do some sort of synchronization over shared memory. And this is nothing but an mmap call. And once you do an mmap call, specify offset 1 as the offset within the connection, it automatically takes the remote registered offset, and then the buffer appears in the local virtual address space. So that is the so that's how mmap works on SCIF. So finally, this is an example of the SCIF usage where the Linux RDMA APIs are layered on top of the SCIF API, kernel level API here. So the stack is, you know, starts from MPI application all over, you know, in user space, all the way down to the SCIF interface in the kernel. So this particular driver here provides an, a software emulated HCA. So it provides the queue pair, send receive queue pairs and completion queue pairs and so on. It essentially emulates a queue pair that you find on an InfiniBand hardware adapter. And then it uses, it actually, so this is for communication with another coprocessor or with another host, with the host or the coprocessor. And so it basically sets up a connection with a remote SCIF driver. And once that connection is set up, it's able to send some control messages using send receive and use the RMA APIs to do the transfers. What actually happens on platforms is that most of the HPC platforms that are using the MIC coprocessor today also have an InfiniBand adapter. So since the low latency message here actually is actually going through the kernel, the low latency messages or the small messages end up still going via the InfiniBand adapter if it's available on the system. And the high bandwidth transfer happens through the SCIF driver here. So it's a mixed approach on systems that where you already have an HCA, it uses different paths for small messages and bulk DMA transfers. So this is an example of the SCIF RMA performance. So, you know, when the DMA is initiated from the host, we get pretty close to the available PCIe bandwidth at about 256K of, you know, at about maybe one megabyte or maybe it's 2 megabytes. But you know, quite early on at 256K, we are above 6 gigabytes per second. So the DMA transfer bandwidth is a little bit lower when the DMAs are initiated from the coprocessor, and that's mainly because the coprocessor is operating with a simpler x86 core. So all the code that is needed to get from the offsets to the physical pages and then program the DMA controller and so on, that particular code gets in the way. And so the effective DMA bandwidth you get is lower. Finally, with respect to the code status and future plans, so the patches have been submitted for the OS state management and the virtio device support. We expect inclusion in the 3.13 kernel. The future patches are going to be for DMA, for the DMA engine itself that's on the MIC coprocessor and its usage in the virtio devices, and then also the entire SCIF API, both the kernel level SCIF API and the octal interface. So in summary, the MIC driver enables an all Linux platform, so you have Linux running both on the host and the coprocessor. The new features that we have introduced are virtio for PCIe endpoints, stolen the idea from virtualization, And then the SCIF communication for high bandwidth bulk data transfer. A lot of this code actually is actually machine independent. So a lot of it involves just messaging over ring buffers and translating virtual to physical addresses, or sending page lists over to the remote side and so on. So I mean, in general, that kind of code should be adaptable to other pieces of hardware that have a similar usage model. So maybe there is hope for a common subsystem for these kinds of PCIe devices in the future. So that ends my talk here. Thank you.
So does this require a KVM on the underlying host,
or is it just driver? No, the driver handles, driver is doing what KVM is doing, basically. The interrupt relay and so on is happening through the driver, yeah. We are using, for virtio itself, we are using the tap interface, but it's actually through user space, yeah. Yeah, we can use vhost. We are looking into using vhost, but the slowness, actually we have also implemented a native virtual Ethernet driver that just does transfers through the kernel, so it's basically native. So that also maxes out at 400 megabytes per second. So what we think, in general, the interrupt routing is from the basic interrupt routing is from DMA to a processor on the mic, so it's generally the same processor taking the interrupt. That's another, yeah, if you can do multiple queues. Yeah, we haven't added the multi-queue support, so hopefully we can add that in. So you could, so there is actually, we are planning to work on a direct sockets interface through SCIF. So basically, it's similar to what you're saying there. Yeah. We haven't done that, but that's. At the base level, it's a PCIe device. So it exposes a sort of an aperture into all of the mic memory. So that's. Yeah. Not really. So in the case of the InfiniBand adapter, it's actually through some kind of setup code. Once there is some setup code involved, but once that setup code gets out of the way, the mic processor is actually directly talking to the InfiniBand adapter. Yeah, you can do that. Yeah, if you have something like maybe things like SRIOV may simplify it, but that's not needed. Yeah. But you do have the, when the When the NIC is pulling data, it's a read across, it's a PCIe read, peer-to-peer reads, which actually have not performed as well as writes. So that's another angle to keep in mind.
Is all this open source?
Yeah.
Where does one
find it? So I have links for to the, there's a backup slide there that has a link. That. Yeah, that has links to the entire stack. So, yeah, but it's not, so we are upstreaming this driver into the kernel. So it's open source, but the driver itself, parts of the driver are not yet available in the Linux kernel.
So does MIC, the processors that are in use on it, do they use quick path interconnect, or is every core coming down the system in order to get instructions?
They have their own ring interconnect that talks to the local memory. It's not quick path, but yeah, it's equivalent.
Yeah. You're also saying for the lowest message latency, you go through the idea adapter and back to the connection?
Well, the lowest latency is actually if you directly mmap memory, right? But that doesn't happen in the OFET stack. So, you know, the way the OFET stack works is because they have the IB transport also available. So they end up choosing the IB transport for the smaller messages. Yeah.
But everyone wants to communicate out of the box.
Yeah. Yeah. Outside the box communication is via the InfiniBand NIC. Yeah. There is no NIC on the device itself. So. Yeah. Well, the OS is Linux, so anytime you make a system call, the OS is going to get invoked. But there are some system services, like some daemons and so on, that are bound to a particular core. But in terms of the OS, it's just Linux, so it just whenever it's invoked, it will run on the other cores. Yeah.
So it's not like a special OS for the OS.
Yeah. It's symmetric. It's a shared memory configuration. So I need yeah. Yeah, hopefully, yeah. So, for example, if the card OS or the coprocessor OS crashes, then we have mechanisms to pull that crash dump over to the host side, similar to kexec creating a crash dump, and so that customers can send over the crash dump to us so that we can debug it. Yeah. Yeah, so we propagate it to the driver. For example, RAS errors is one class. So those are, yeah. There is some persistent logging of the error, but it's propagated through to the host driver. Yeah. So we also have to make sure, for example, when those kinds of errors are happening, or happen rather, we have to make sure that the other devices that are interacting, the other coprocessors that are interacting with this particular coprocessor are their communication is shut down, and then we can go through some kind of reset process for this particular one and then bring it back up again. So, yeah. So the host driver has some sort of keep alive mechanism and things like that to make sure that the OS has not crashed. And so.
And the individual part of the coprocessor, essentially.
Actually, it's. I haven't read the public documentation myself, but it's. Any write that you do from the host side will invalidate data in the coprocessor CPU's caches. So you don't need any special fencing or something like that. And when the coprocessor writes to system memory, that will also invalidate data sitting in the host CPU's caches. So it's almost like just like shared memory, essentially. I don't understand your question completely, but are you referring to direct cache access or something like that? Or?
The write combine writes, the bypass, the dump invalidate the writing CPU's cache lines on the way out.
So what happens is the coprocessor memory itself is mapped write combining into the host CPU.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So it's like a graphics adapter in that sense. Okay.
So, sorry, I feel a little bit silly asking this because I might just not be understanding something. But it seems like you've put a lot of work, good work, into creating a programming level to offload the work from your main process to your coprocessor. Where is the advantage to this over just populating a system with a whole bunch of inexpensive cores and running in the best of you?
Yeah. So on the first slide, I had something about at least the current generation of MIC provides, I think, four times the performance per watt as the Xeon processors. So power savings. Yeah, performance per watt is the main vector here. So these are actually do fit in with that that philosophy of smaller processors. These are much smaller than the Xeon processors. The majority of the logic in these processors is taken up by the SIMD instruction pipeline. And so it has x86 for the compatibility and things like that, but. I think that's in the works. Yeah. I think the next. So the next generation will be available actually in both form factors. It will be a bootable as well as a coprocessor. In that case, coprocessor is a migration path for folks who have started. Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Thank you.